I've got a few of these controllers. It's hard to store them in a small space without bumping one of the buttons, which makes it scan for the console and waste a little battery each time. I found a great 3D scan of one online and thought it'd be interesting to intersect it with my own geometry to make a form-fitting stand. Fusion 360 doesn't let you do much with raw STL model imports. There are a few tutorials that tell you to disable your design history and use the mesh to BRep tool so that you can do more. That will fail unless your model is very simple, so you have to remesh it down to fewer than 10,000 faces and lose a lot of detail. Even then, the result is completely covered in sharp corners. If you try to do anything interesting, it's hard to get a good result. I dug around a little more and pieced together a better solution from a few different guides. It takes a few extra steps, but the results are worth it. This first step is optional, but Autodesk makes a great little utility called Mesh Mixer that's a free download. You can manipulate STL models almost like modeling clay. I spent a few minutes smoothing the 3D scan of the controller. I didn't want the screw holes at the bottom of each leg to cause any trouble later, so I smoothed them away. Once you're done in Mesh Mixer, just export it as another STL file. This next step is the important one. Autodesk has another app called Recap Photo. It does a lot of interesting things, but we just need it for one tiny utility. The website tries very hard to convince you that you need an expensive subscription to use the app. But, if you look carefully, there's a free version that you can get just by letting the 30-day trial expire without subscribing. Once you get your STL file imported, there's a nice feature that will detect any issues like holes in the model. The controller model was already nice and solid. All we really need from Recap Photo is its ability to export quads instead of triangles. Fusion 360 can do something with quads that it can't with triangles. And you can have more than 10,000 faces this way, too. All you have to do is pick the OBJ quads format when exporting. Now we're ready. Do the usual import mesh step in Fusion 360. The rest still requires you to disable design history, so it's best to do all the conversion work first and re-enable it right afterward. In the Sculpt menu, there is a convert tool. We need to use it twice. First, convert the quad mesh into a T-spline. You can safely delete the first mesh. Now, use it again to convert the T-spline into a BRep, and then delete the second mesh. That's it. Now you've got a nice, smooth Fusion 360 body that you can use with their full complement of tools. After 7 or 8 prototypes, I settled on trying to have the controllers packed together tightly while standing up. So I was going to need a couple of leg cups. After splitting off the parts I didn't need, I wanted to add an extra 0.5 millimeter along the inside of each cup so the controller's fit wouldn't be too tight. That's exactly what the patch menu's offset command does. I actually ran into a repeatable crash here when I tried this without smoothing the screw holes first. Fusion 360 didn't like offsetting the sharp concave holes. Once I offset each side, I needed to make a new lid and stitch it together to turn it back into a solid. We'll be able to use these expanded legs later to carve things out. While prototyping, I decided I wanted to avoid overhangs to make printing these as straightforward as possible. So, I just grabbed the biggest contour I could find, offset it a few more millimeters, and extruded that the whole way down. Laying out the rest of the basic shape is simple enough. A nice curvy platform to support the center of mass, a rib for stability, then fillet. Now we get to subtract the leg cups. This is where being able to use an imported model like any other Fusion 360 object really shines. There isn't any reason to completely enclose the controller legs. Slicing off the sides saves a lot of plastic, reduces printing time, and helps to keep the stand's footprint smaller. This part is silly, but if you're going to all the trouble of making something that's going to be out in the open, dressing it up a bit can make it a little more fun. I inserted a decal of the Nintendo Switch logo and just traced over it in a sketch layer. After some careful offsetting to add a fraction of a millimeter between the negative and positive versions of the logo, it was ready for 3D printing. First, a double check with the controller in place to make sure everything is going to fit the way I expect it to. In the past, I've left this step out and didn't notice a major design flaw until I'd already printed the thing. Without any overhangs, things went predictably well. Depending on your printer, these will either be a snap fit or require a drop of superglue. I really like this ultra gel control stuff from Loctite. In the end, they did a nicer job than I was expecting. The stand fits like a glove. There isn't any wobble, and you can pack them into a very compact space now. So, the moral of this story is to avoid the faceted, low-quality STL to BRep conversion built into Fusion 360. It only takes a couple extra steps to get a much higher quality, better behaved result. If you'd like, you can download the controller stand from Thingiverse. I also put a list of the conversion steps in the video description below. Thanks for watching.